It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn Bustos into Robustos. Brought to you by StackhomeCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tihan.
What's up, guys?
Hey, what's going on, guys? What's up, Joe? I like the way they introduced my name ahead of yours, so they got dumb.
We're going to have to get that fixed. ASAP.
No, it's perfect the way it is. Cash Play is brought to you by StackhomeCoaching.com. Rethink poker and use promo code QuadJacks82 for a free day trial. If you guys want to get better at poker live, online, whatever, we have some great coaching over there. And I think everyone's losing value if you want to improve on your games by not taking advantage of this offer. So anyways, today, Joe and I were discussing over the weekend, changing a few things around. I think since we're very accomplished pros, for a long time also, we have a wealth of information to share with everybody out there, our listeners. So I figured we'd just like not get into any wishy-washy stuff and just go straight to strategic stuff and just, you know, tap into our vast valley of knowledge, right, Joe?
Yeah, I mean, I called John after our show last week and I said, you know, no one's ever going to want to listen to us as radio show talk show hosts because we're just not going to make it. I mean, I'd much rather listen to someone like Marco, but, you know, when it comes to talking about poker and talking strategy, I think both John and I have really good insight to the game. So we're going to try to focus primarily on that.
Right. So we want to maximize the value of this hour of our show to our listeners, actually listen to try to improve their games instead of us offering thoughts on what's going on in the poker industry. And we'll leave that to Marco and other people who do a great job at that.
Yeah.
So, okay. So first thing we want to get into is listener emails. We actually got an email, an interesting one. This is from Corey. His email is, I am fairly new to PLO8 and prefer to play it over Hold'em now. Can you and Joe explain 3-bet ranges and how to polarize hand ranges in that game? Also, what are some spots where you can bet super thin, knowing certain situations? Can I mention this last part, Joe?
Yeah.
He wants to learn how to stack Joe in the game in Ventura. So I guess he's plays with Joe on a semi-regular basis. So you can take this.
And Corey, I know Corey's a really funny guy, really cool guy. But I don't know. I think he just wants to learn how to stack me in the game, which shouldn't be that difficult. But like looking at his question, I mean, explaining 3-bet ranges and how to polarize hand ranges in that game. Like, we haven't talked too much about PLOA, although that's the game I've been playing mostly, recently. And I know it's been spreading kind of in various areas. And it's a really fun game. The biggest difference between PLO and Hold'em, it's like there's so much more information in PLO. You have 4 cards, and you know you're almost always going to be up against some sort of nut, like some sort of draw to like a nutted hand. You know what I mean? So everything you do in like PLO it's mostly all about value. You know what I mean? Whereas in when you're playing Hold'em, it's you're kind of betting for information. You're kind of betting for value. You know, you're later on in the hand. It becomes more of a value game. But like in PLO, like you pretty much know where you're at like the whole time. You know what your good starting hands are. You know what your good flops are. So it's like it's all about getting max value in certain spots.
So are you saying there is not much bluffing going on in PLO 8?
I mean, of course, there's bluffing in every game.
But not as much.
It's not nearly as much as in Hold'em. No, I wouldn't. It's all a game of like, you know, am I getting the most value when I have the best hand, or am I paying off too much when I'm behind? Things like that.
It just seems like there's a certain line you should take depending on your cards. Whereas in No Limit Hold'em, you can deviate from that and try to represent different hands. But in PLA, you're pretty much kind of handcuffed to play your hand, and you're just saying you need to get max value when you can and need to just know when to get away. Even with sometimes like nutted hands, I guess sometimes you have to fold the nuts, right? Because you might get quartered or whatever. if it's
too late. I don't know. People have said that to me.
I don't know.
I don't remember ever doing it.
I mean, I don't like to admit that I'm not very versed in a certain type of game, but PLO 8 might be the one game where I have the least amount of experience.
I'm sure so, once you play it a little bit, you'll get a good hang of it.
I've played it before, trust me. There are spots where I'm not sure what to do. So, but I find this question kind of interesting because he's talking about three betting a polarized range in PLO 8. Does that even exist? Like just three betting hands in PLO 8? Like,
I mean, the worst hand I don't three bet like too much with, like, you're not three betting with crappy hands. It's the same thing as before. Like, the most you can three bet is like the size of the pot, and usually the guy that opened in the first place probably has a better hand than you. So it's like, there's no real reason to like three bet as it is in hold'em. You're three betting all for value. You know what I mean? I'm three betting all my value hands. If I think I'm ahead of my opponent's range, then I'm three betting those.
So you're never three betting a hand like 3, 4, 5, 6.
I mean,
that would probably be for, I don't know.
I'm trying to think of
the other side when he's asking if there's a polarized range you can three bet. I know in PLL there definitely are. You can three bet hands to get it heads up, a polarized range. But PLO 8, it just seems like, since you already mentioned, we're playing our cards basically and just trying to play optimally. Do you want to have like trash hands we're three betting with? Is that viable?
No, I don't really think it's going to pay off all that much. I don't do it, and I don't see it done at all. And you're just throwing away money. I mean, a lot of times you're up against dominated hands, and yeah, you might have position, you might have aggression, but just overall, like, you know, guys are gonna know, okay, well, I have like this draw with this hand, and I'm a, you know, and it doesn't matter, like, even if they think you have like ace ace whatever, you know what I mean? You're trying to like rep one thing, where it's really hard to rep anything in that game. It's like everything is going to be out there. Like, if you don't have it, your opponent's going to have it. So, like I said, I'm just not three betting at all in that game without value hands. And it's the same thing with like raising preflop. Like, my raise sizing, or I think raise sizing, it's all about what you're trying to accomplish. You know, if you have a hand like ace, deuce, 3, 4. Like, I talk to a lot of people, and they have, like, ace, deuce, 3, 4 playing, whether it's Omaha 8 or better, or, like, PLO 8 or better. Like, people won't want to 3-bet. People won't want to raise with a hand preflop because they're like, oh, well, why don't I just call and see the flop, and then I can go with it. I mean, well, like, even you can answer. Like, even you say you don't know much about PLO, but you definitely know, like, you should be raising that hand. I mean,
yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. Our three betting range then is basically all for value. It's never bluffs ever in this game, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That's the answer. Okay. And then another quick question he had was, are there certain spots where you can bet super thin? And I remember we had a discussion about this where you mentioned the no-limit player, pretty proficient no-limit player, playing PLO 8 for maybe like his first time or one of his first times, and you were noting that he was missing some obvious value betting spots on the river. I mean, to some guys, I think this is what Corey's talking about. Some guys, it might look thin, but in your eyes, it should be a bet for value, right? Like, I think the guy had like second nuts and a big high hand. He didn't have nuts either way, but it was heads up, so he's almost never getting scooped, but he checked back the river because he wasn't nutted either way, right?
Yeah, and like, you know, and no one else would really. I remember the hand he had, like, and if people don't know how to play PLO 8 or better, I guess this is even bad to talk about. But in this hand, he had Jack 10, Deuce 3, and the board came like Ace 6 or Ace 5, Jack, and he bet, got called in one spot. The turn was a 6. So he had the nut low with deuce 3. The board was ace 5 6, and he had deuce 3 for nut low and a pair of jacks. And the guy check called again, and then the river was an ace. And I was actually there watching him, and I'm like, wow, that has got to be the best card in the deck. Like, he should always just bet the pot here on the river, because it's likely the other guy's check calling down with a hand like, you know, deuce 4-5 or 3-4-5 or and some sort of low with maybe 3-4-6 or deuce 4-6 or you know, you could have an ace with a worse low. But I mean, you're almost never ever getting scooped when the guy check calls two streets there. You know what I mean? So
well, I didn't even know he had nut low. Yeah, he has nut low. Plus a semi decent high hand and it's heads up.
So. Yeah. I mean, it's better than a decent high hand with a jack there. And and then he checked back the river, and I was just thinking, wow, like, you know, and these are the spots like in poker that people don't even realize when they're winning. Like, he just raked in the pot, and he never even thought about it. He's like, oh, maybe I should have bet there. But he didn't really care because he's still dragging in a couple $100 pot, right? So people don't even think about that. And I think that's like, John and I were talking about this earlier, and I think it's like a really, really good point to make. It's like the ace-queen hand that the one kid was talking about. Why don't we talk about that one, JK?
Okay, so we'll move on from PLO. So your point is people are missing value bets in PLO 8 because they're worried they're going to get quartered, stuff like that. I guess he had the nut low, so he's assuming he might get quartered, so therefore he's taking the safe route. But if he understands PLO 8, it's hard to get scooped, then he should definitely be value betting. Most of the time, he's going to get three quarters. Sometimes he's going to get called by the second nut low with like a pair of sixes or whatever. So those are spots where, for experienced players like yourself, it's an auto value bet, but some people might think it's thin and they check it back. But again, it just takes experience and knowledge of understanding PLO 8. Have you ever played with Mike Matisau on PLO 8? Because someone asked.
No, I haven't.
Okay, so you don't know how someone asked if he's any good or not. But I heard he's a pretty good mixed game player, so I'll give him that. The ace-queen hand is kind of a similar concept. You want to mention the hand, Joe?
Oh, the ace-queen hand. Where is that? Let me see.
Okay, I'll just say.
Yeah, go ahead. Read.
It's a 1-2 game. The guy buys in for $100, so 50 big blinds. He raises, under the gun raises to 5. Hero raises to 20. Button calls, under the gun calls are 60 in the pot, 63 in the pot. Flop, ace, 10, 5, rainbow. Under the gun checks, hero bets all in for $84 into a $63 pot. He figures top pair, second nut kicker, might as well shove. Button calls, under the gun folds. And his comment is, I think I messed up my bet sizing here. I shoved because stack size were awkward and it was a small over bet. I think Button's range is pretty strong when he cold calls. Obviously, I agree with that. Maybe sets, ace, queen plus. I don't think I'm ever not going broke here with such a small stack to pot ratio, but I think I could have done a little more to keep ranges wider. This is the hand. What do you think about
that? Yeah, I mean, like, the one thing that I always say to really, really, if you really want to improve your poker game, it's like, whether or not you win or lose the pot, I mean, it's hard not to be emotional at the time. When you win the pot, you're happy about it. When you lose the pot, you're pissed. But it's, you know, you just want to think about things like after every pot or after every big decision, it's like, okay, should I have played this differently? And, for instance, this ace-queen hand, I mean, it's almost a no-brainer. The guy's almost always going broke unless he sees the guy's hand. The guy's pretty much always going broke. But the point is, like, what's the best way to get the money in? How are we gonna induce, like, worse hands to come in? In this spot, I mean, you know, shoving $84 into a $60 pot on an ace-10-4 or ace-10-5 rainbow board, like, is, like, very bad. It's very bad. I mean, you know,
for most amateur players, it seems like it's just the play to make. You have a little over pot. Like he said, he has a little over pot bet. He has top pair, second nut kicker, so why not just shove it in and hope for the best? But I know exactly what you're saying, and this goes back to the PLO 8 hand, is we tend to overlook things, and we're missing out on a lot of value in the long run when we tend to overlook things. Like the kid didn't value bet his deuce 3, jack 10 spot, and he was content with raking in the pot then, but he probably left an expected value of, you know, say the pot was 1,000, he probably left about 200-300 of value out there, theoretically. And then in this spot, yeah, the end result, the guy had ace-king that called him, and he ended up losing a stack, but the end result, no matter what he did, it's going to be the same. He's going to lose his $100. But we can't look at it like that. It's, even though in some hands the end result is going to be the same no matter what line you take, there are definitely plus EV, better EV lines to take. And like you said, shoving is bad because of it goes directly correlates with this point I'm making, is that you're giving up equity in the long run, even though the end result in this specific one hand might not matter. But we have to look at every hand, like what would create the most equity in an infinite sample number of hands. So if we bring up the situation in an infinite number of hands, we don't want to be over shoving here, because we're just going to be getting called by ace, king, sets, stuff like that. We want a value bet like 30 to 40-ish with 40 behind, and we just call a shove. This way, a couple of reasons why we keep the calling range is wider. When we overshove, we're usually going to just tend to get called by. It's the old adage, called by better, fold not all worse. But if we bet half pot, whatever, we can get called by way more wider range and some worse hands. So,
You know, there is a fine line, though. I mean, you see a lot of people who just, like, you know, they'll raise preflop, and now, and I see this with a lot of tournament players. It's like they'll raise preflop with like a hand like king queen, and now it comes like, you know, king 10 7 or whatever, and now they'll like check, and they'll like check call, they'll take all these like weird lines. I mean there's a fine line between you know, keeping in worse hands but also betting to protect your hand. You know, in a spot like that where you have king queen on a board like that, you almost always have to bet, because you're getting value from like a ton of draws that are going to call you, all sorts of straight draws and flush draws and, you know, double gutters and worse kings, whatever it may be. You know what I mean? So I think there is a fine line between, you know, betting for protection and, like, you know, not over betting to where you don't want to get it to a point where you're only going to get called by better hands. Like,
all
right, on a board like king 10 7, you have king queen, you're going to get called by a lot of worse hands. But, you know, but on the flip side, like on a board like ace 10 5, where you shove for 1.2 times the pot or 1.3 times the pot, you're only getting called by better hands. So, I mean, I think there is a fine line, you know, in betting for protection with certain hands and you know, just I don't know, I kind of like spaced out there.
It's okay. But yeah, I think the main consideration, again, reiterating our point, is a lot of stuff for most players, it's just going to come like secondhand, and they're going to overlook things and say, well, I have top pair second kicker, I'm supposed to go broke there. Yeah. So it doesn't matter what happens. But in reality, there's a lot of spots where people are missing out on value in the long run by not taking the most optimal line. And they're just results-oriented. We get caught up in that all the time. Poker, a big mistake most poker players make is being just results-oriented. And, you know, I tell everyone in poker, like, it's not about results. It's about making the correct decisions. Even though the end result here is the same, but you're actually, in theory and in equity-wise, you're giving up a certain amount of dollars equity-wise over the long run, and that's going to add up to a ton of money. So the best players in the world, I like to classify myself and you as up there, but the best players in the world definitely think along the lines of, like, how do we gain the most equity in the spot? It's not about, you know, like, oh, we want to win this hand, we want to protect this hand, blah, blah, blah. But it's all about EV. So even though, no matter what, you know, there's been many hands where you and I have spoken, said, oh, you're going broke no matter what, which is a very simple statement. But there's a means to get to that point, a good way and a bad way of going broke. And even though it may not matter in this one specific hand, but it definitely matters over, again, a large sample of hands if you're in that same situation over and over again. So that's basically the point we're making. But let's go on to this next hand. I was coaching a student last night, watching her play 1-2, and I want your thoughts on this spot. I want to get into a little bit about preflop bet sizing. There's a very spewy, splashy, bad player. He had like $400 at 1-2, so he had a stack winning a bunch of hands. He was opening a lot of hands. So he raises a 12 under the gun in a 1-2 game, and she's got, the hero here has about 250, so a little over 100 BBs, and she 3-bets in position to 60 with pocket eights, and the guy ends up folding, and you know, I thought her 3-bet sizing was very poor. What do you think about her 3-bet sizing there?
I mean, it's kind of an awkward example with eights. I mean, yeah, but like, in general, when 3-betting, like, you know, you want to keep it 3 times, like, somewhere around 3 times, like, as a basis, you know, for a reason. I mean, and it's kind of like the similar reason. You're gonna get action from some worse hands. Whereas, you know, when he makes it 12 and she makes it 60, like, she's never getting action from worse hands there. And that's pretty much the biggest reason why you shouldn't be making it 60. However, I mean, if the guy is, like, you can do funny things in live poker. I don't think it's, like, as bad as, you know, especially when you're explaining this guy, like, in the way he, like, plays, he's super spewy and splashy.
Yeah, he's spewy, but he's not, like, a total clown. I'm pretty sure he's calling, the great point you make is his calling range is pretty much becomes really narrow based on her 3-bet size. Her 3-bet sizing is going to affect his calling range. So when she 3-bets that big, her eights, equity-wise against him, his calling range goes down because he's going to tend to play his upper range more when she 3-bets that big. Like, he's going to play, you know, like, bigger pocket pairs, ace-jack, ace-queen, king-queen suited type hands, and he's going to let go of 4-5 off, ace-4 off, 5-6 suited, probably. Hands that she wants in that eights does well against. So that's the main reason why is she's, when she 3-bets really big like that, she's narrowing his calling range, and she's actually losing overall equity with her specific hand of eights against his calling range. So had she 3-bet to, like, say, 36, like, 3 times, or, you know, online, it'd be more like 2.5 times to, like, 30 or whatever, you know, she's keeping his calling range much wider, and she does way better with her specific hand. Now he's going to be calling with ace-4 off, 4-5 off, you know, 9-10 off,
but I mean,
4 suited.
What do you say? I mean, like, what do you say to, like, the average kind of recreational player? I mean, you know what I mean? Like, this is for someone who's really thinking about every aspect of the game, but, you know, the average recreational player is like, well, I just want to get it over with there. Yeah. They're not comfortable in playing. They're not comfortable in playing, well, yeah, like, these 3-bet pots.
Right. Well, it's not even 3-bet. It just comes down to bet size. This is why people say 1-2. People make it 20 or 30 with jacks or 10s, and then they win $3. They're like, oh, I'm happy to win $3 because jacks are so freaking hard to play post-flop. So,
it's the same
line of thinking. It's, they're giving up equity. I mean, everything, I explain in terms in equity, like, you're leaving money out there. Sure, you win $3, but that hand is supposed to make you on average of like $12 or $14. So you're losing an extra $9, $10 over the long run by making it that big. And a simple way to answer why you shouldn't raise that big is you're only getting called by better and you're folding out all worse. And that's basically what's happening. When you're making it 10 times a big blind,
you can see why people do this, though, JK. You can see why people do this. Like,
they're making a mistake.
Of course they're making a mistake. I understand they're making a mistake. But people, like, are sometimes uncomfortable playing in these 3-bet pots. Like, they're, you know, if they 3-bet... I mean, you see it all the time. Like, someone 3-bets to, like, $40 with kings, and now the flop comes ace, deuce, deuce, and they're like, why didn't I raise to 200? You know what I mean? Like, people just don't know how to react once they get outflopped.
Yeah. Right. Like, well, actually, here's, I mean, it's, yeah, last, yeah, I was, like I said, I was sweating this 1-2 game early on. The, it goes raised. Actually, I was in the game with my student. I made it 6. I don't remember with what hand. Guy makes a 16, cold call. Next guy makes it $116. Like a huge overraise. Everyone folds, and he shows aces. This is exactly the line of thinking we're thinking. And of course, his comment was exactly what we're talking about. I'm happy to win this pot now. I don't want to see a flop. That was his statement.
Yeah, like, my favorite one is like raise, call, re-raise, call. And now, like, the guy on the button goes all in. This is in, like, a 1-2 game, and the guy had, like, $500. And he goes all in for $500. And he says, you're all beat. says it out loud. He's like, you're all beat. I don't know. You know, I don't want to take a bad beat. Or, you know, some guys even, like, show their hands or whatever it is. I mean, and again, it's the difference between human nature of – rather, you know, of course they're giving up a little bit in long run profits, but to help keep their
a little bit, I think they're giving up a lot.
Well, of course, yeah, they're giving up a lot in like long run profits, but to help keep their sanity and to help keep their
it's the emotional side of poker. People want to feel good. They don't want that shitty feeling when their aces get cracked. So they rather feel good and win $30. Then try to maximize win 100 and at the risk of like a 20-30% chance of getting aces crack, and they're going to be on life tilt for the next 2 hours or whatever. Yeah. So they're not looking at it rationally. They're looking at it emotionally. I mean, I'm trying to do my best Jared Tendler impersonation here. So yeah, your question is like, how do we teach these people to think differently? You know,
I mean, it's like, yeah, it's like when I'm explaining, you know, and when I work with people, like, they want to, like, coaching, they really want to get to, like, the next level of, like, how can I do this, like, professionally? You have to, like, totally just get rid of that mindset of, and it's almost like a mindset of, like, just total human nature.
That's what it is. I always tell, you know, say, like, when people get emotional, the human element. And I'm just going to point to myself because I think I'm a good example. Is the reason why I've done so well is I leave like pretty much all emotion out of poker. It prevents me from going on tilt. It prevents me from making these irrational decisions where it's costing me equity over the long run. So yeah, I mean, I would just tell people, leave your emotions out of it. Think everything rationally, logically, and in equity. Don't think in terms of, you know, the goal of poker is not to win the most pots or whatever. If you're winning the most pots, you're long-term loser, guaranteed. So if you're shoving in 200 with aces pre-flop to not get called, congratulations, you're going to win like not 100% of the time with aces, but yeah, you're not going to be a winning player over the long run. So, you know, it just comes with experience too. I mean, people need to get familiar. The reason why people do these is because they might, there's a lot of it, besides emotions, they might not be comfortable playing post-flop. So you and I are very comfortable playing post-flop, and we're always thinking in terms of EV. So that's why we always look for the optimal bet sizing pre-flop. So this goes, yeah.
And I think that's a big part of it. You know, the more you practice with, like, 3-betting to, like, a whatever the standard size would be, you know, the more you practice, like, 3-betting to a certain size, like, the more you're going to get comfortable and, you know, after that 3-bet's already done, now you just, like, the thing that I think that all the best players are good at is, you know, in college I studied economics, and the one thing you learn about is sunk costs. Like, once you 3-bet, and, like, let's say she 3-bet to $36, like, that $72 or $75 is in the pot. Like, and now you have a new decision to, you know, now you have a new, everything's new, like, you know, the board's going to be new. You may no longer be in the lead after the flop or whatever. You're going to have $170 left, and there's going to be $75 in the pot. And, like, everything's a new decision. And I think it's important to, like, focus on that. So, you know, when you 3-bet in spots like that, Whether or not, like, you know, sometimes you're going to go broke and get the rest in behind, or sometimes you're going to, like, have to check fold or whatever. But I think the more pots you play that are like that, the more you'll be able to, like, kind of sit back, you know, reevaluate the situation once the flop comes out, and you'll be like, okay, now here's my best decision from this point on. But, yeah, you know, it's just people are afraid, I think.
Just a couple of things to wrap up this hand. Someone said a standard open in my live 1-2 game is 15. I think I don't want to say you should never open big. I think you want to have a go for your bet sizing, and it also depends on your opponents. If people are calling like big bets preflop, then I don't see anything wrong with opening to 20 if you're getting two callers whenever every time. So I would open 20, 30. With aces, kings. But I'm saying in general, people are usually going to call with really good hands at just whatever stakes. If you're opening 10 to 15 BBs with your standard opener. But if people are there to gamble, then I think it's fine. So there's a few exceptions is the point I'm making. And the other thing about raising a certain size preflop or 3-betting a certain size preflop is to kind of set up a certain stack to pot ratio to play post-flop. This is all about having a plan in poker too. We talk about this all the time. In order to do well in poker, you always need to have a plan. So even though we're talking about just basically pre-flop and what's wrong, what's right, but we want to have in the back of our mind a plan going forward with this hand when we do get called, our stack size and what's optimal for our stack sizes with the specific hand we have. So that's why we would 3-bet smaller with maybe like hands like 5-6 suited, while we 3-bet a little bigger in hands like 2 jacks, 2 queens, because we want to have our stack to pot ratio be bigger with suited connectors, small pairs, and we want the stack to pot ratio to be smaller when we have really good premium hands, so it's a lot easier for us to get it in all in on the flop. So it's kind of a couple of offshoots from basing our preflop bet sizing. So anything else you want to add about preflop bet sizing,
Joe? Well, there was like one more thing I wanted to talk about. This was like an interesting hand, and I told you about this from the LAPC in which I played, and this was like the 10K buy-in main event, and you start with 30,000 in chips, and it was literally like my first hand at the table, or one of my first few hands at the table, but there were like two very bad, I shouldn't classify them, but from my reads, you know, they were older guys, kind of like really bad players, right? And it's spots like where I think overbetting is, we never really talked about this, but like, one guy limps for 100, I raise to like 350 or 400 with 10-9 suited, and now both of these old guys called, and the flop came 6-7-8, and I had 10-9, right? And now they both checked to me, and there was like 1,000 in the pot, and I bet 5,000 on the flop. And like, I ended up, they ended up both folding, right?
Well, what do you expect? And I've talked to like... You 5 times potted it, dude.
Well, yeah. Well, here's the point, though. But my point is, it depends on what I think their calling ranges are. I mean, like, I got a read on these players, or not a read, but I'm like looking at these players, and I'm like, well, these are two types of guys who I think will never fold to overbets on the flop. They'll just never fold to, like, if they flop a set or like a lower straight or whatever. They're just never going to fold. So I thought, why not just build a pot right now? And hopefully they have one of those hands. I don't know. I thought that was an interesting hand to like bring up or talk about. JK, where'd you go? I lost.
I'm here. My video shut off. But yeah, we already argued this. I disagreed with you. I agree with you with the overbet, but I disagree with your actual sizing. That is way too big. And again, I just... same adage, you're only getting called by better. In this instance, there is no better. and you're folding out all worse. In this instance, everything else is worse. So I don't think...
But that's not true, though. I don't think I'm folding out all worse. That's why I totally disagreed with... You know, I've talked to a couple different people about this hand. I don't think I'm folding out all worse. I think I'm getting the money in.
I think there's a high probability you're folding out all worse. I think it's... The bet sizing, the EV and the bet sizing of getting called.
Yeah, against a good player, they might fold
compensate
like
for the the frequency of your getting called by worse hands. So I you know, have to disagree with your bet sizing on this hand.
I think you're totally wrong. I think against a good player,
You're sporting an LA Clippers jersey. Who's right or wrong today? So come on.
All right.
Well, let's bring on our guest, Mike Kelly, aka Ken Aces. Maybe we can ask him some of the stuff we disagree on. Mike's a long-time pro online and live, and he's been coaching for a few years. So we'll bring him on right after this break.
All
right. And now your hosts, John Kim and Joan Tihan.
All right, so we're back with Mike Kelly, a.k.a. Ken Aces. I'm going to go over a little background of Mike. Been playing professionally since 2007. Beats up live games, 15-30 limit hold'em, 500 NL. And also, you've been a pretty consistent winning online player on Stars and Full Tilt pre-Black Friday. And you've been coaching for about 4 years now, so you have that under your belt. I'm sure you can provide a lot of insight. But one thing I wanted to ask you, Mike, and welcome to the show, Mike.
Hey, John.
Hey, Mike.
And
Joe.
My co-host, Joe.
Nice to meet you. I don't know if you've ever met him.
He's the guy that likes to overbet five times pot when he has the nuts.
I heard.
And fold out everybody.
Did you hear that hand, Mike?
Well, I did.
Finally, we get a logical thinker on the show. I'm sure he understands value.
Well, I mean, I'm not a tournament guy, so I can't really say too much, but I kind of feel like you get called by sets and fold everything else.
And
especially if you said they're older guys, like my generic older guy read is weak tight, so you know, they're just gonna like, you know, even pitch tens or something or jacks or something.
Of course I'm losing value from like nines, tens, jacks. I'm losing value from like 8, 9, things like that. But
my argument is that you can gain a lot of value by overbetting, but not that big. Maybe 2K, 3K, like two times, three times. And okay. Yeah, and also this is a 10K buy-in. It's what was a level one. People are not gonna call those bet sizes and go broke level
one. Yeah,
they're
not gonna call. That's the point.
The tournament.
They're not gonna call. Yeah, but they're going to say, oh, wow, I flopped a set. I can't fold. I'm all in. Like, they're not going to call. I realize they're not going to call. Like,
well, you just answered why you're wrong then. They're not going to call. So why would you
They're going to shove, like, all these hands they realize they can't. They'll realize, well, I can't get to showdown with this hand. Man,
even bad players are going to want to, like, you know, play a couple of hours and get their feet wet and have the experience of playing a 10K event.
So how deep were you that you needed to overbet the flop?
We started the hand with 30K. Everyone started with 30K.
300 bigs deep.
How much, Johnny?
300 BBs deep.
Oh, 300 BBs deep. Okay, so yeah. I see. You're trying to like blow the hell out of the pot on the flop.
Yeah, he's just, yeah. I mean, this is almost the same lines of like betting 500 with aces in a 1-2 game, Joe.
That's so wrong.
So if I ever play with you, Joe, I know you might have slight bet sizing tells.
Yeah, when he's betting five times pot,
you have to understand my read. My read is that they're never folding like two pair or sets or like lower straights or anything. So yeah, why not build it to the point where they just have to get it in?
I think in like 200 or to 500 buy-in tournament, sure, but in a 10K event, I doubt they're calling enough. Often.
Yeah, that's a small. You can't really.
There must be a bunch of millionaires playing 10Ks. So,
I mean, if someone's in a tournament, they're just going to play poker the way they know how to play poker. And these old guys know that, okay, if I flop two pair or a set, if they could beat aces on that board, they were going to go with it. They were going to shove all in, I think.
Whatever.
Because of my bet.
Let's talk about Ken. I wanted to ask you, Ken, or Mike, I'm sorry. I keep calling you Ken. That's so funny because I had
that's
you on Skype as Ken. So where did the name Ken Aces come from?
That's I don't even remember. I think when I started playing online poker a million years ago, I just came up with the dumbest name I could, and that happened to be it. So no good stories.
I don't even know if that
I wish I'd picked something much better because now I'm stuck
with it.
That's
not original. That thing is like a boring name. No knock on you, Mike. But
it is a dumb name. I hate it, but I'm stuck with it.
okay, so I wanted to ask you, it says in your coaching profile, which is located at cardrunners.com, where I do make some videos, but it says you're a poker dealer for a year, which has allowed you to understand how both the good and bad players think about poker. Can you kind of elaborate on that?
Yeah, I dealt in a underground poker club at different points for 1 to 3 nights a week. And it was a sort of a trip just to hear everybody talk about the game, watch about the game, you know, see the game from, you know, the box, from the dealer seat. Gave me a different perspective on everything. And man, was I having flashbacks when you guys were talking about PLO8. Because for a time, I was actually dealing a PLO8 game and playing one regularly.
Oh, how was that? Did you learn anything dealing that game?
Yeah, I learned how to efficiently chop pots as a dealer.
That's true.
It's just that easy if you don't play that game. The sickest live game I've ever played in actually was a 5-5 blind, 1,000 max PLO8 game that I think 4 guys crushed and everybody else lost because they didn't know what they were doing. I've never seen good players have a bigger edge than that game. And it only lasted 2 months because all the weak players went broke, like literally broke. if you play versus weak players in that game, boy, they don't stand a chance if you know what you're doing.
Right. I think Joe would agree with that.
It's a really good game, PLO8.
Yeah, it's one of those games right now where it's so, I don't want to say it's very new, but it's overall most people haven't played it, and it's going to be new to most players. So if you know what you're doing, then it's kind of equivalent to almost like No Limit of 5 years ago. So it could be a gold mine right now.
I think it's true. The only drawback in the live setting is it's really slow. Like hands per hour is going to be cut in half from an Olympic game. It's really slow. So
yeah,
that hurts your hourly.
Right. So, okay. So and you've been like, I like the fact you're kind of like me. I played a lot online and pre-Black Friday, post-Black Friday, you've played a lot live. You probably played more live than me, to be honest. I'm not sure. And you're thinking about moving to Florida. And we're talking about this right before. You're saying like you're checking out the 1-2 games, maybe even dabbled in it down there. And you're saying the rake was abnormally high. And how it affects people's win rates. Do you want to touch on that a little bit?
Sure. I didn't play any 1-2 when I was there. I played 2-5 no limit and 5-10 no limit. But the rake was the same structure for 1-2, 2-5, and 5-10. And they take $7. What they do is they take a $5 rake and they take $2 for promotionals, you know, high hands, various tournament seat giveaways and such. But man, if you're a 1-2 player and you're paying $7, almost every hand. Wow.
When they take money for either the bad beat jackpot or the high hand, are they paying it back 100% or?
I couldn't answer that in any detail, but I'd be willing to bet that they're never paying back 100%, right? They're going to take at minimum some kind of administration fee. And you know, for the player who pops into that room once in a blue moon, like, they're never going to see that money. I mean, even for the regulars, they'll win a high hand every now and then. But they didn't do a lot of bad beat jackpots.
Yeah, but Ken,
it was more like high hand this hour, give away a $65 tournament seat every now and then kind of stuff.
Yeah, we talk about everything in terms of equity, though. You know what I mean? So if you're dropping a dollar, it doesn't matter if you're going to be the one to hit that high hand or not. Like, if they're dropping a dollar for the high hand, whether or not you hit it or not, you're probably losing, like, 25 cents on every dollar or whatever it may be, like, because we're thinking of everything in terms of equity. So like, yeah, I mean, realistically, yeah, the rake is probably 5 plus, you know, an extra like 30 or 40 cents on each of those drops, right?
Well, yeah, I see what you're saying. It's, you know, it's 5 plus 2 for a total of 7, but maybe your equity of that $2 is, you know, some percentage. But as far as what they actually pay out to the players, I don't know. I just know that, you know, if there's an opportunity for a casino to make money on it, they're gonna.
So, are you saying that people in Florida should avoid the 1-2 games because the rake is so high? Or it's just hard to overcome that? Or your win rate is not gonna be very high because of the rake? And people are just not very aware of how much rake affects your overall win rate?
Yeah, I haven't really thought of it in terms of whether or not I would tell someone not to play 1-2, but it's gotta be a factor. I mean, that's a big rake to overcome. especially because the game isn't deep. It's not like Vegas where you can play a 1-2 game and buy in for, you know, a lot more. But down there, they're capped games, so the buy-ins are 200 or 300 depending on where you are. And there are a lot of players at the table who are buying in shorter. So then the rake becomes, you know, even a bigger piece of the pie in terms of affecting your win rate because the pots on average are going to be smaller.
Yeah, I'm kind of guilty of that, just like not paying attention to rake. I just sit down and it's like, okay, let's play poker. I don't even know. I never even check out what the rake is wherever I'm at. But
I'm the same way. It's very bad.
It must be the dealer in me. I noticed it firsthand. Firsthand, they took $7 in a very small pot in a 2-5 game, and I was like, what?
Yeah, I probably would have never noticed if I sat in 1-2 game down there until you told me. I'm like, once you told me it's $7, I'm like, wow, that's abnormally high and be tough to beat that game for a good win rate.
I mean, the way I looked at it, I mean, you know, again, I was playing in a 2-5 game, and they took the blinds out of the pot, right? They took the small blind and big blind out of the pot, right?
That was the rake.
That was the rake, right? I mean, that's, you know, you crazy. Raise, someone calls, you see
bet. What's the point of playing for the whole point of Hold'em, it starts out, your goal is to win the blinds.
I know, they take the blinds out, they're gone.
So they're raking the blinds, what are you playing for, like, initially? Why would you play anything but aces?
Right. I mean, every place plays, you know, has a different speed at which they take the rake, right? But whatever it was on average down there, they actually took it quite quickly. So it wasn't like you had to get to a $100 pot for them to take the 7 out. They took the 7 way before that.
Go ahead, Mike.
It's a factor. It just sort of surprised me as someone who plays much more Foxwoods, Atlantic City, Vegas, where the rakes are, you know, roughly the same. And I think, you know,
right.
much
about easier. What, $4, I think, up to four, sometimes five.
Yeah, depends on where you play in AC. It's 4 or 5 because some of them have a bad jackpot. And then in Foxwoods, the 2-5 game, there's no bad beat jackpot eligible for 2-5, so they only take $4 rate there. And you guys, of course, know Vegas better than me.
Yep. Okay. I want to get to, because you have a background in both live and online, and we were talking about this before, decision making and why it's important. And I thought we had a pretty good conversation. I wanted to share it with our listeners is how you come to decisions live versus online and how it's different for those people that are trying to go from one to the other or trying to learn both and how it's different. You and I are mostly online backgrounds. Joe is mostly live. So as online players, we relied on HUD. And actually, you brought up a couple of interesting points about using a HUD. A HUD is a program that shows stats of your opponents. And I was saying, you know, as online players, we should base most of our decisions on HUD. And actually, you corrected me. What did you say about using a HUD?
Well, I think that, you know, the HUD is an awesome tool. I mean, after having been mostly away from online poker, just this past week, I installed, you know, the latest, greatest software package, you know, the new Hold'em Manager 2 and all the bells and whistles. And it is amazing how much data is in there. And there's no question they're really powerful for game selection, for leak finding, for reviewing your own play, for finding and exploiting leaks in your opponents, and all that stuff is great. But I once heard it said, and I wish I remembered who, because it was probably a poker video I watched, but I don't remember who, that the HUD is frequency data. All you get is frequencies. It's a bunch of statistics about how many times someone does X in situation Y. And that's great and useful and important, but sometimes online players forget what I call direct evidence data. What hands do they get seen at showdown? How did someone play some part of their range in a certain situation? And sometimes I think there's a tendency, at least in the guys I'm coaching at sort of, you know, lower stakes, no limit hold'em, to really become HUD bots, where they forget to think about the poker, forget to think about equity, like I heard you guys talking about earlier. They forget to talk about ranges, and they're just looking for the magic HUD statistic to make a decision for them rather than learning the fundamentals of the game. And then when they go play live, they're not used to sort of observing, remembering, retaining, using that direct evidence, you know, seeing a showdown, seeing how a player plays, and extrapolating what that might mean for another situation against that same player.
Right. Yeah. I like this comment you made. So HUD is basically information frequency data, and live hands is basically direct data from showdowns, and you based your decisions off that. But like you said, we have a tendency as online players to be too reliant on HUD and just kind of overlooking the fundamentals of the game and taking the proper lines.
I agree, Mike. Like, I hear a lot of times, you know, when people give a hand history, they'll say, well, you know, they'll never tell me, like, what happened in the hand. They'll be like, well, I sat down at the table, and this guy played five hands in a row, and he raised all five hands. And or you know, whatever, I'm like, you know, get on to the hand that just happened. Like, because a lot of times, you know, you can make slight adjustments, but overall, I think things like that, it's way overrated. You can make slight adjustments for, you know, based on your read or based on, like, you know, I really think this guy's, like, super wide here or something.
You're saying fundamentals should overpower, like, the frequencies at the rate people do things.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
right. So, and I wanted to share a couple of things when it comes to the HUD, because I always like talking about HUDs, anything related to online, is when I first started playing online, I never used a HUD. So, and I did well because my game was more of a feel and just kind of reading people and never tilting or whatever. But as the games got tougher, I realized to stay ahead with everybody else, all the kids were using HUDs and stuff. I mean, whatever, I started learning how to use a HUD. And then people are kind of pounding into my head, HUD is very important doing that. I remember, Joe, you had a roommate at the World Series from Canada, and we saw his HUD, and he had like 50 stats when he grinded like 12 games. And I was just like, whoa, I was blown away by that. Because I'm using my HUD, I have like 6 stats, like the VPIP, PFR 3-bet, faulted 3-bet, aggression factor. That's probably it. And he has like 50 stats. And I'm
like,
what
the same way.
Hell?
I had like 6 or 9 stats or whatever, or 6 stats, but I mean, I really only looked at like the top 3. Their VPIP, their PFR, and their 3-bet percentage, especially their 3-bet percentage. That one really helped, I thought.
Yeah, I see this kid, your roommate, for the summer, and I'm like, wow, like, do you actually use all of that? And his response was, yeah, use all the stats and come up with it. I'm like, and I was just thinking, is this what today's game has come to? It's just like being so reliant on all these stats and basing your decisions. So I don't know. So what I ended up doing was incorporating more. So I went from 6 to, I have this little notepad that shows all my stats. I have probably about 20 stats now, but I probably still only look at 6 of them when I play. So I guess my mentality is, well, I guess everyone's doing it, so I have to do it. But when I play, I think what Mike was saying, you were saying, I just think of fundamentally wise and base a lot of my decisions that way. Every once in a while, I'll look at these stats. I mean, like a turn or river when a guy raises all in, then I might go into some of these specific stats. But overall, I just revert to my fundamental understanding of the game than relying on these HUD stats. I mean, a couple of stats that I've been using more that I never used before was full to 3-bet and flop check raise, just because the online games are so aggressive.
I actually think I use the stats more than you do, John, listening to that description. I look for, obviously, for seat selection, game selection, they're huge, right? You know,
right,
just to be able to find the weaker players. But also, even against the regs, I'm always looking for spots where I think that maybe I can exploit them. You know, a spot where I feel like they might be unbalanced, and I'll look for those things in the HUD. And again, I'm blown away by the new stuff. I think it makes it sort of easier to tease out. Instead of looking at a sea of numbers, it feels a little bit more like you can, you know, maybe use more of that information in an in-game setting. But even to review someone's game, like if there's a reg you're playing with all the time, I've definitely gone into the stats, not while playing, and just gone crazy trying to break out someone's game so I know exactly how to, you know, win more or lose less to them, depending on who they are.
Right. Let's move on to live play. So, online we're, you know, rely on our fundamental game with a lot of help from our stats, from our HUD. How do you base your decision in live, since we don't have a HUD on hand? And we're talking about a couple of hands you played recently. So if you want to share that, that's fine.
Sure. I mean, I think the fundamentals are kind of the same between the games. with one major difference in my mind, playing online, the vast majority of pots wind up being heads up. Six backs or even full ring today, you know, you raise, someone calls, or you raise, someone three bets, and you're heads up on the flop. Whereas live, you know, you're much, much more likely to be in a multi-way situation. Are you guys still there?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, I got a funny thing on my screen.
Don't worry about it.
That's okay. So I think the fundamentals are the same. And because the game is so much more of a multi-way game, you know, you see four or five players go to the flop, even in a raised pot is so common. That means that in a live game, I'm probably playing much more about pot equity and much less about fold equity. So, you know, I'm doing a lot more thinking about, can I value bet? Really, that's my live game. Can I value bet? I'm always looking to value bet. And I think that's where I make most of my money. The hand example that John and I talked about earlier is funny because for me, it's not so common, but I actually made money in this example, bluff catching, which is, you know, not usually a huge source of profit for me. I think most of these live games players still continue to call down way too much, way too big.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point, Mike. Way more money in live poker, especially, is made from value betting as opposed to bluff catching. I can't really say like how much more is made one way or another, but it just, from my experience, it's like tenfold. I mean, it's incredible. I think
I couldn't put a number on it, but I agree. It's a big difference. Like, and one of the sort of theory things that I talk about in the coaching, both live and online, is just this idea of, you know, that you make money in poker by basically fold equity plus pot equity, figuring out where you are with those two variables, and, you know, betting when you have a lot of fold equity and or a lot of pot equity. And if you write that equation out, money equals fold equity plus pot equity, when you go to play live poker, just cross out the fold equity part and focus on the pot equity. and that gets you like, you know, 80% of the way there, I think. But yeah, anyway, so John asked me for a hand, and this was kind of an idea related to this direct evidence, in that, you know, I might have a general idea that someone is loose or really tight, in other words, some general idea of their frequencies in a live game. But beyond that, you know, what do I know how many hands in a row they played in the last 3 hours? But if you're watching and paying attention to every showdown, there's a lot of stuff you can learn. And I think this hand is kind of an example of that, and maybe an example of, you know, some fundamental things. So this player in a previous hand had a pair of kings and a flush draw on an ace-high board, and I had check-raised the turn as a semi-bluff. And he called, and he rivered a king, and I checked, and he checked back trip kings on a board where, like, trip kings was the nuts. So I know that this player does not value bet thin at all. And I'd also seen him when he did value bet earlier in the session. It was more like half pot kind of value bets on the river. So that's the background. That's sort of the direct evidence I had leading into this hand. Let's see. I was in the big blind, and I believe I had king eight. It was a limped pot, five, maybe six way. I checked the big blind. We go to the flop. 7-8-5. So I guess I should say 8-7-5. Two spades. And I just value bet my hand. I think I have the best hand here. I don't want to give, you know, free looks at a turn because I'm very likely to be outdrawn. I think I can bet and get called by worse. I get one caller. Everyone else folds. We go to the turn. The turn is an ace. I think his range is still very much, you know, weaker eights or weaker one pairs or maybe some draws. So I value bet the turn, and he calls. Again, the flop was 8-7-5, two spades, ace on the turn that was not a spade, and the river is the six of diamonds. So we go to a final board of ace-7-5, ace six, where the flush draws have missed, but, you know, there's a four liner to a straight here, so it's certainly a scary board. I checked the river out of position, and he bets $50 into what was probably a six. I know I didn't get all the bet sizing in the story, but the pot's probably 60-ish at this point, and he bets 50 on the river. So this is a large bet in this live game. And he did it in such a way that it looked very much like, I'm so strong, you know, kind of a strong as weak tell, right? He gave me the stare down and he just sort of like smacked out this $50 in the middle, like, you know, I'm the man kind of a thing. So immediately alarm bells are going off in terms of like the tell department. But then I stopped and I was thinking, and I realized that this guy is never ever betting two pair on that river. He can't bet trip kings on the river. How could he bet two pair? And if he's never betting two pair, he doesn't really have a lot of nines in his range. So this is where I think fundamentals can really help. If you, after a session, go back and find some interesting hands and actually work through the math, work through the fundamentals, you can find a call here. And I did call, and he had busted spades. I believe it was a king-jack of spades. But what do you guys think of the hand?
I don't know. I mean, I thought that was a sick call. I think I would tend to fold more than, because I'm scared on those boards. 4, 5, 6, 7, or 5, 6, 7, 8 board. What do you think, Joe?
I mean, that sounds like a pretty good call. The only thing I do think that's important when looking at history is some guys, especially in live poker, and it's like, this does help when you're like watching the game, when you're not involved in hands, where it's like, how did he ever check back the river? Like in the spot with the kings, it's like, how does this guy ever check back the river? So like when thinking about this hand, I would, you know, you can pretty much eliminate him value betting all aces up, all two pairs, all probably even a four, right? Like I don't think he would bet $50 with a four in that spot, right? Like 50 into a $60 pot. It just doesn't seem very logical. It seems like there are a lot of combinations of like 9, 7, 9, 8, 9, 5.
Actually, Joe, I probably should have mentioned it. The eight of spades was either on the board or my hand. I don't remember which now.
Okay.
So he can't have 8, 9.
Okay.
And he's not going to call the turn bet with just a gutter ball. So the 9X combos that I'm thinking he can possibly have are, you know, they call flop and call turn are something like ace 9 of spades, 10 9 of spades, jack 9 of spades. And that's all I could come up with.
I mean, you don't think you would call the turn with like middle pair plus a 9, like.
Like 7 9?
Yeah, 7, 9 or 8, 9 even.
9, 10 gets there too. The top open ender.
And 9, 10 for the top open ender.
I think the reason why Mike called is because his observation from the previous couple of hands, and that's the point Mike's making, is that we gather data. We don't have a HUD, so we gather data from history, previous hands, just watching, like you said, Joe, observing players when you're not in a hand, or when you're in a hand. And yeah, just the way he played hands on the river led Mike to believe, okay, well, he's never value betting here. His bet sizing makes no sense based on his previous history. So this feels like more like a bluff here. And, it, you know, if you include like combinatorics of just, you know, combination of hands, you know, Mike thinks it's weighted towards busted draws since he tends to check back like a four, never betting sets two pairs here on the river. So the only thing you can have is a 9X type hand. And Mike just thinks there's a lot more combos of bluffs than nines. And I assume that's what Mike was thinking when he called the river.
Like I'm not even sure he's got 10-9 off in his range to call the turn, this particular player. Like I think if he calls the turn with 10-9, I kind of would be surprised. I'm not saying he couldn't ever show up with 10-9, but I definitely am discounting 10-9 without the flush draw, you know?
Right.
And 10-9, like, that had the flush draw and the straight draw, might have raised the flop or raised the turn. All sets, I'm sure, are raising flop or turn, so he never has a set by the river, unless he, like, rivered pocket sixes. But he might not even bet pocket sixes like this guy, I mean, on that board. So
yeah,
I think he winds up with something in the neighborhood of, like, 15, depending on his exact limp range, he probably has something like 15 or so. Actually, this is kind of fun. It's one of the things I do after a session is I scribble it down and play around with numbers, and I found my notes on it. And I think I worked out my estimate was something like 16 or 17 combos of busted flush draws and just a handful of combos of 9X of spades, like literally just four or five. And you're right, maybe he has 10-9 off some of the time, or, you know, 10-9 of a different suit. So maybe you add a few of those in, but still he's at least half of his river combos, if not even more than half, are just busted spades.
Yeah, I kind of tend to think you might be underestimating the number of 9X types in his hands. Joe might feel the same way, I think. But the point we're making is, yeah, I like how you're using previous data. Again, since we don't have access to a HUD, we gather information and we, you know, apply that. Poker is just a game of incomplete information, and then we try to make the most plus EV decision. Yeah. And you know, your call is probably plus EV. You say it is, so I'll just take your word on that. So, what I'm saying, the conclusion is that you've used your previous experiences with this guy to come to that decision.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think it's a mix of the combinatorics, a mix of the bet sizing. Like, I don't think he'd even bet that big if he had the straight. He'd want to get called, so he'd bet 20 or 30. And then, you know, the physical tells.
And he gave you the stare down.
Yeah, you know, like all that rolled up together, I think, made it kind of a fun spot. It's probably a terrible hand for us to talk about on the show, because now we're like recommending people check call rivers against big bets, which is, I'm sure, like, you know, close your eyes and check fold big bet on rivers is probably the best line in a 1-2 game anyway.
It's funny that we preface this conversation by saying,
exactly,
you don't make money by bluff catching, and then you tell us the sand, which is like, right. Totally.
That's good. Next time I'll try to do a value bet hand.
Yeah. No,
but I like our original point is just gathering data and stuff like that. Like I was saying last night, I was playing with a student 1-2, and there was a certain player I was getting involved in a lot of hands with, and here's a couple of hand examples really quickly. And like a four-way pot, the board is 8-7-4, ace-6, so any five mixed straight, and there's four diamonds on board. And he leads out into four players, and another guy calls. And one of my student's friends has two red tens with the 10 of diamonds, and he hero calls the river, over calls. The guy that called was a bad player, too, in the middle. And neither of them had a diamond, which is crazy. Here the hand. It's different if, like, they have the bottom pair turning a bottom pair into a bluff, but it's suicidal betting into 3-4 guys. The guy that bet out has ace-7 without a diamond. He has aces up. So I'm like, what the heck? That could be the worst bet in the history
sick
of poker.
Value.
I don't know if he's going for value. What is he doing with that hand? He has aces up on a one-card straight, one-card flush board.
The other guy has a straight.
The guy has ace-5 for an 8-high straight. And with two guys behind him, he calls that hand. And so my friend made the right call because he knew these guys are both bad. And I'm just thinking, like,
I think that's kind of funny to talk about, but it is kind of important. Like, you see people who will fold behind there where they think they might have the caller beat, but they're, like, worried about the guy that bet and whatever. And it's like, now that the guy actually called and you think he may be calling pretty light, like, now you're even getting that much better pot odds. Now you only have to be right, like, instead of, like, you know, the first bet, you have to be right, like, 1 out of 2 times. Now another guy calls. Now it's like, okay, I only have to be right 1 in 3 times. You know what I mean? So that's even more incentive to call with, like, you know, the 10-high flush there.
Yeah.
That's a good call.
And this guy also bet pocket fours on like a king 10-7 six deuce board in a spot where he's never good. So the rest of the night I was calling this guy light. That's the thing, I gathered information. This guy, when he bets the river, I don't think he knows what he's doing, so I have to pay off with any semblance of a hand. Obviously against me he always had the nuts, whatever, but everybody else he had in the air. So
he had top two against you just on better boards.
It's funny you say that, John, like that the guy was betting the four pocket fours on a king x board, because there's been a bunch of live spots where I'm just dying to make ace high calls because it makes sense for them having nothing, and then they wind up with a hand that, like, you're describing, they should basically never bet, like the betting bottom pair, because they don't know what else to do and they don't want to check fold or something crazy. So it's like a little rule that I try not to make too many ace high call downs, even when I feel like, God, I want to call this spot, because people will turn over the most ridiculous bottom pairs too often to make it plus EV.
Yeah, they're bluffing with the best hand is what ends up happening. Yep. So they think that. But anyways, I want to thank you for coming on the show, Mike. Again, your coaching profile is up at cardrunners.com. Are you accepting students now?
Yep. If anybody's interested, they can hop on CardRunners and look in the coaching feedback thread where people have said some nice stuff about me. I also have a blog under Ken Aces, or they can Skype me at Ken Aces with no space, just K-E-N-A-C-E-S on Skype.
Yeah, and you're pretty proficient in online and live, and you can probably help people that want to make the transition from one to the other too, so, which is awesome, and there could be a ton of value in that. So did you say what your going rate was for coaching?
No, I didn't, but it's 50 an hour.
Yeah, which is very, I mean, that's, you know, really good value, I think. Yeah. I think $50 an hour, so it's very good. Okay, well, are you on Twitter or anything?
Nope, not on Twitter or anything, but, you know, 15 hours seems great to me, because if people want to pay me 50 an hour to talk about poker, I can't complain.
Okay.
I talk about poker for free all day long anyway.
Right. Well, thanks again for coming on the show, and you can follow Joe at Joe T. Han on Twitter. Me at Nicolak Poker on Twitter.
And I hate email. Twitter. I hate Twitter, Mike. Don't even bother.
I actually like Twitter. It gives me something to read while I'm grinding live. Just kind of see how deep everybody is in tournaments, stuff like that. Okay, and email me at john@stackandcoaching.com and joe at joetpoker@gmail.com. And again, thanks for listening, guys. This is cashplays@quadjacks.com, brought to you by stackemcoaching.com, and we'll see you guys next time.
All right, thanks, guys.